Kevin calling in from New York. What's going on? You're live on Talk Heathen.
Hey, thanks for taking my call.
Yeah, for sure. How could we help?
I've talked to you before on Truth Wanted, and it's the first time I talked to this other host. Good to talk to you.
Oh, sweet.
Thanks for calling in.
I'd like to discuss something that you may or may not have heard of. It's called the Eternal Now philosophy. I'd like to discuss that topic and try to explain why I think that a God is involved in this.
Could you is that
perennialism? Is that what you're talking about?
Well, I think the Eternal Now philosophy actually stems from Zen thinking from the Buddhist religion. You see, Okay. Even though I'm a Christian, I do like to study other religions and see what they say about the world and so on and so forth.
Okay, I'd be curious to know how... Are you trying to demonstrate God through this, or...
Well, yes, because to put it in short, this kind of does have to do with time and space and how this philosophy thinks about these very things. Basically coming from the accusation that we're already living in an eternity, but time, as we think of it, is just kind of a construct, you know what I mean, that happens within our minds.
No, well, no, we'd have a disagreement there. Space time is physical.
Well, yes. See, when even though it's physical, space and time is so intertwined that it could be actually the same thing. And that.
Okay, how do you actually? How do you actually differentiate that? Because, like, I know that you can say that, like, we can all say certain things about it, but how do you, like, what method do you actually use to determine that? Or is it just an armchair thought process? Like, do you have any novel predictions at which you could make, which would separate those or make that not the case? Because the novel predictions for space-time have been, you know, substantiated, right? So you would have to have a new novel prediction. You wouldn't be able to use the work and post hoc rationalize something. You're going to have to actually create some prediction in the future at which testifies to your hypothesis. And then you would have to actually show falsification for it if it wasn't true. Do you have any of that?
Kevin, you still there? Hello, Kevin. Oh man, Kevin has dropped the call. Actually, I don't know if you scared him, J. Mike, or
if it's just a simple question. If you have to have predictions for the hypothesis, otherwise, I'll just take any drunk guy at their word for what they say.
Yeah, I'm assuming you dropped. If you want to try to call back in, we can certainly try to talk to you again. I don't know what happened there, but I guess my first thought is I heard a lot about eternity and space time. I didn't see how any of that had to do with God. I'm not sure why any of those things or any of the claims he made had to be true in order for God to be real, or like vice versa. Like, I don't understand where that was going to go.
Well, in the premises, it's like his conclusion's getting to God, but like, I can't even grant his premises because he's already made a mistake to assert space time is something, or time or whatever is something. He's basically claiming it's something else. If that's the case, if I got him correctly, if that is what he's saying, well, then he has to demonstrate the soundness of that premise, right? Like, otherwise, I don't need to move on to his next premise. The argument's done.
Side tangent here before we go to the next call here, too. You know, like, these kinds of grand philosophical inquiries into God and its demonstration of God's existence are just, I don't know, it rubs me the wrong way, if only because, well, look, like, for the most of, like, human history, or at least Christian history, like, you didn't need that for, like, the average person. You know, like, God just appeared and people, like, believed it. Like, I don't know why it has to be so complicated for me. And I get it. Like, Christian philosophy has its own background and its own history of people, like, developing the faith. And I understand that that's that's there. But like for the vast majority of Christians, that has never been required. None of these arguments have been required for them to believe in God. And it kind of just begs the question, like, are people believing in God for really bad reasons? Because if they are good reasons, why aren't we talking about those reasons? Why do we need something else in order to like supplement our worldview there? So
yeah, I don't exactly know. And you're not using them to get to the conclusion. Like, I don't know anybody that's like, oh, the modal ontological argument is why I believe in Yahweh.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah,
because if that's the case, like, you know, I could use the inverse of that argument to say, well, God doesn't exist, right? Because that's kind of, the arguments going to that entailment of a perfect God or whatever the arguments go to. It's like none of those arguments are the basis of someone, why someone's an atheist or a theist. It's just some post hoc assessment after the fact. At least that seems to be the case. I'm not saying nobody's ever changed their mind, but it does that is usually something to add on to after the fact.
It does seem that way.